experience. I was in my 20s when that started happening. And I think the thing that helped me get through that experience was actually talking to people about it, which some people didn't like that I was talking about it. But what I found is that as I talked about it, I got a lot of support from people that I would never have even guessed would be supportive. So instead of just keeping it inside, I was able to talk about it, sometimes through humor, and got a lot of compassion and understanding, even from people I didn't know well. And it turns out, you know, a lot of us have these experiences. We just don't talk about them very often in our culture. So,
and what about your sibling? What helped him or her get through that experience?
I think his support, his family support. So the fact that we didn't disown him and that we were there and going to visit all the time, and he knew that he was loved, and that, you know, just kind of the message that people make mistakes and that sometimes those mistakes are really big and everyone can see them, and sometimes those mistakes aren't big and people don't know, but that it didn't matter, that we still, you know, would support him.
And how has it turned out now that he's probably not in his 20s anymore?
Yeah.
Was he resilient?
He is resilient. Yeah. He has moved on, which is good to see. Yeah.
So the social support comes up a lot in terms of how people make it or don't make it.
Yeah, I think that, you know, especially with a situation that's very public and something that is, that our culture does not, that is a stigma, you know, in our culture, I think that's really hard. But I think that the more honest people are about what's going on, that you do find support, you know, and that if you do talk about it, you find support. And, yeah, and I think family support, and by family, I don't just mean people that, you know, are your
blood relatives,
yeah. But, you know, the family that you choose. I think that knowing that people love us no matter what really fosters resilience.
I read a study of kids in Kauai that were really disadvantaged, and the ones who made it had a mentor. It could be a community group or a teacher or a grandparent, but having at least one person or group that believes in you makes all the difference.
Yeah, yes, I think that's very true. And, you know, what that does for us, which I think is really important, and this starts when we're born, is that it's someone who sees who we are. And if someone can see who we are, not just what we're doing, I think that's really important, because then we know who we are when we're seen by someone. And as kids, if we know who we are and bad things happen to us, we can hold on to who we are. But if no one sees us as we are, you know, and we don't know about ourselves, then when things happen to us, we tend to kind of adopt whatever's happened to us as who we are. And that's not, it isn't who we are. It's just something that's happened to us.
Do you see clients who've had that experience where they don't really have an identity that's clear? They haven't been seen?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think with some of our, how do I say this? Like the people in our community who we all can look at and see, oh, that person's having a hard time. I think often that is the root of the problem, that they didn't have parents who could reflect to them emotion and what they were feeling as little itty teeny tiny babies. And so here they are as adults, and they never had that. And I have had clients, and I worked with kids and adults who really struggle from not having been seen when they were little, and they don't know how to see themselves.
What do you think about the ubiquitous use of cell phones? You know, I know when I take my six-year-old little guy to the park, the parents are more often looking at their cell phone than their child.
Yeah.
And that seems like it's really unempowering and doesn't make you feel seen, literally.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think that, you know, we are all confused about our use of technology in the sense that we think that we're connecting. And maybe we are in some ways, but really we're disconnecting. And I notice when I get on my phone, it's because I need to disconnect for a few minutes, and I'm trying to be really conscious about that. But what happens to children who are around people who are disconnected for whatever reason, because they're on their phone, because they're drinking, because they're high, because they're perseverating about something, because they're whatever's disconnecting them, the child can't put that into context. So what they understand is what I'm doing isn't important enough for my parent to watch me and to see me. So I think it's a huge issue. And I think we all need to think about it. You know, how do we disconnect, and why do we disconnect, and how are we affecting the people that are around us?
I read a book by an MIT professor about how people feel so alone but so connected electronically, and right. She talked about kids who threw their parents' phones down the toilet, or mm-hmm. you know, because they didn't feel like they were important.
Right.
Now I'd like you to meet Rochelle Richmond Colbreth, and she's a high school counselor at Pleasant Valley High School, and her career of 22 years has included every age group. She finds that exploring the theme of resilience and learning is a critical conversation in her work. Teaching students ways to develop a resilient mindset while experiencing setbacks and adversity is something Rochelle considers to be central to her work. So could you tell us a little bit about that? Tell us a little more about how you define resilience and what you see as patterns in the students that you work with.
Well, I think it's different depending on where the student's coming from. So a student who I'm having to, you know, consider making a CPS report, and the whole
Child Protective Services.
Yeah, and so they're in an incredibly dangerous home situation, or they're being physically abused, and that kid shows up the next day at school to meet with the social worker, or maybe they're there in the next couple days when they've been sort of stabilized. To me, that is the epitome of resiliency. But it's also the student that comes in and sees me and says, look, I'm really, really struggling in this math class. I've struggled for the last 3 years. I'm not good at math, they tell me. And I'm like, you know, let's try to you know, rethink that. You know, what are you telling yourself? And what is it that you've done to survive for the last 3 years? I just had a great conversation with a really cool girl who was down on herself because she was feeling like her grade wasn't what it was supposed to be. And, you know, the thing is that resilient aspect of her was the fact that she sought out tutoring, and she stayed after school, and she was getting, tutoring from Upward Bound through Chico State, which kind of relates to what Katie was saying in terms of having that mentor, that person. And it goes beyond that, because it isn't just the mentor, but it is that student being willing to participate in other activities to expand them. So resiliency is built on, being willing to put yourself in a risky situation or experience a challenge and pull through it, you know?
It sounds like it's also about asking for help.
That is a huge... I had a big conversation today about somebody, you know, being a self-advocating, being able to go and know who to ask for help and that it was okay. And it was a younger student, so we said, you know, the idea was, hey, this is something you're going to learn. You're going to get better at this. You will know exactly what to say when you're starting to feel overwhelmed or starting to feel, you know, fragile. The fragile teacup was a good conversation I had with my other counselor colleagues at school. So,
what did they say about that?
Well, that's...
For listeners, a lot of college people who work with first-year students, we say first-year student rather than freshmen, and they report these fragile teacups who fall apart at the time that they get a C or there's some little problem because they've been so protected by their helicopter parents who, solved any problem, ran interference. And this is a phenomenon that's being reported around middle-class families in Europe and the U.S. and Canada. And there's always really overwhelmingly controlling parents in Asian countries who sit on their kids to make them study to pass the all-important college test, so it's not just a Western phenomena. So did it, do you see these fragile teacups? Oh, my God, I can't cope.
Well, what we were talking about this morning was that the what we see as fragility is really a lot of students feeling really stressed, overwhelmed, really anxious, feeling like they're, you know, taking on too much, and that gets scary for them. And you know, it that is kind of what they were saying. They felt that we're definitely dealing with that on a regular basis. And some of it has to do with, you know, their own ability to understand how to deal with a struggle, and that struggle is part of learning. It's a process. The helicopter parents, there's a new term that we were talking about, is lawnmower parents. Did you mention that? Lawnmower parents. In fact, I talked with a mom about this a couple weeks ago, and we had a good chuckle over it. But the lawnmower parent is the mom or the dad or the family, whatever, that tries to clear the way. You know, they just move all the obstacles aside so that the student has a clear path. And what parent wouldn't want to do that? You know, it's totally understandable that a parent wouldn't want to, you know, make it easier for their kids or rescue them when they're suffering, and that makes a lot of sense. It's hard, you know, to know when it's okay to sort of let the chips fall where they may versus, you know, stepping out of the way and saying, hey, you might really learn something from this. So that's another wonderful part of our jobs, is that we get to work with parents and support them, because they're learning resiliency. You know, if a parent is sort of wanting to give in, it's because they're getting pushed on by the student, right?
Yeah.
The student is saying that teacher's mean and you don't understand and they never even give me the homework. And, you know, the parent's got to kind of think, well, wait a second, that can't be true. I'm sure you have the syllabus and the dates for the tests, and so let's just think this through and how you can get through this. So conversations and communication is really, I think, a huge aspect of sort of living through that moment of adversity and coming out on the other side.
An interesting idea is that primate youngsters and human youngsters need rough and tumble play, chasing, climbing trees, falling out of trees. That's the way they learn to cope with stress.
Yeah.
So if people are so afraid now, I can't let my kids play in the neighborhood because they could get kidnapped or bombed or something. So kids don't get to have that experience that most of us had of climbing trees and running around the neighborhood and feeling totally safe.
Well, I guess what that makes me think of is another way of looking at resiliency, which is how quickly do you bounce back? You know, when there is that you didn't get selected for the team, or you did get that grade that you have to repeat. You know, it's the attitude, and that's how quickly do you kind of say, what's my plan B, plan C? And I think one of the professors that I was reading an article about was saying that having that conversation about what if you fail, it's not an insult to the student, it's not like not believing in them, it's saying
what's the worst thing that can happen?
Yeah, what's the worst thing that can happen? And so the fragility sometimes is that story that they tell themselves is, well, the worst thing that could happen is, and they make something up in their head that is just so far from whatever is the truth. And so sometimes the worst thing is you repeat the class, and they think that's just going to be the end of the world. And hey, it might be the best thing. And particularly, I'll be specific, if you're talking about math, hey, that was where I was the worst.
Me too.
An avoider, and oh my gosh. And I, to this day, I just have a total fear of, you know, numbers and trying to keep it straight in my head and all that. So, but I really do think I needed more coaching and more mentoring to just kind of say, hey, you know, you'll get it. There's a new way to, you know, just be patient with yourself. Being patient is huge in you know, developing resiliency skills.
Well, what about how many students do you see? I'm asking because I'm thinking there's these huge high schools and a staff of how many counselors, how many students can really say, I need help, and get an appointment with you? Marie's nodding her head.
Oh, I was counting the words that I wrote down.
Oh, okay.
What do you think about that?
I think that
Marie is a high school student in Chico. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. I think it really depends on, like, the student, if they have a deeper connection with their teachers or, like, their counselors and stuff. They don't feel as open with them because they're like, advising, like, school and stuff. And I think that some students don't really realize that they do actually care. And even if, like, say, if they're being abused at home, they're going to tell their teachers, but they're scared to, mostly because, I mean, mandated reporter, like, that's
right.
I think that's the term.
Yeah.
Where you, like, you have to, like, obviously report that. And I think students would be kind of scared about that because maybe, like, their parents are going to find out and stuff is going to happen to them. And
they'll be punished or something.
Yeah, they'll be punished. And, yeah, that's kind of what my intake is on that, yeah.
So as a student, do you have a regular, like, once a semester automatic appointment with a counselor, or do you have to ask for it, or what's the procedure?
I mean, I'm usually, like, try to be independent to, like, help myself bloom in a way. So, like, after I get out of high school and stuff, I'll kind of know what to do and other stuff like that. But I go into the counseling office occasionally, like, if I'm worried about something. Like, I currently have a C minus in my math class. And I'm like,
that's the worst thing that could happen.
Yeah. And I'm just really stressed out about
that.
For
you.
Thank you. I'm just really stressed out because, like, I don't like getting, like, C's or lower because I've always been wanting to prove to myself that I can do better. I mean, other kids think that's great, but I'm like, yeah, sure. Like, it is great. But for me personally, like, my set goals, that's not what I want to achieve. And I want to strive for the greatness and happiness that I want within, like, my grades and scores and stuff like that.
Well, I think that's a big issue when I talk to students in Chico and elsewhere, is they are anxious and depressed, like national studies show that there's been an increase, especially
yes.
in girls, which we'll
yes.
talk about later. And there's reasons for it. It's like, okay, I'm going to go to college and I'm going to graduate with $35,000 in debt. How am I going to find a job that in my field that where I can pay off this average $35,000 debt? And then there's a lot of pressure from parents and family to get A's so you can go to a good college,
mm-hmm.
so you can get a good job,
mm-hmm.
so you can pay off the debt. Mm-hmm. So there's what I realize from talking to students, which a lot of scholars don't do, who write about young
students.
People, which is amazing. So I just have a book coming out in June called Ageism in Youth Studies, The Malign Generation, because I was astounded that people who are scholars of youth studies, really, most books don't even mention one young voice. So I talk to
yeah.
students and now I understand. And also another big factor is they don't get enough sleep,
yeah.
which makes you anxious and depressed because mm-hmm. they're studying until midnight. Do you
yeah.
want to comment on that, Marie?
With me personally, I take the bus home, so I kind of get home around like 4-ish. And so I usually go straight into my room and, like, do my homework and study and stuff. And, I mean, it's kind of hard to also study because, like, I'm still stressed out with, like, knowing that I have, like, a report due the next day or I have to read certain amount of chapters and fill, like, charts out and stuff like that. It's just, like, the homework kind of piles on after a bit and it's a real stressed out feeling to know that, like, you have a bunch of things that are going on at the same time because, like, you have, like, 7-6 classes a day, and each class is different, and you can have homework depending on what grade you're in or what kind of teachers you have, homework in every class, and sometimes it's more difficult than others, takes more time than others, and it's kind of hard to focus on each category, and then switch from, like, Spanish to, like, English or math to whatever other class, like history, and it's kind of difficult to, I would say, like, kind of think about it, because it's just going over and over in your head, because homework and English, and then you have a test to study for in history, and they kind of coincide, like, with the whole, like, 50s and the transcendentalism and stuff like that, and it's just kind of very, very stressful to think that. you have tests while you're also doing homework, and on top of that you have studying, and some kids are in sports too, so they don't get home until like later in the day, and they still have to stay up and then wake up as early as they can to get to school.
So how many hours a night during the week do you average on homework?
I say probably about two.
Two a night?
Yeah, two a night. Like, that includes studying and taking my time on my homework and making sure I know what I'm doing and making sure.
What year in school are you?
I'm a junior.
And where are you aiming to go to college, if you want to share that?
Right now I'm just thinking of taking classes at Butte after I graduate, and then go to a 4-year after, so I just get those main classes out of the way and then transfer.
They have that great program where you can take classes in your senior year in high school.
College Connections.
That is so great, because then you only have to be in Butte for 1 year, and then you can transfer as a junior and save a lot of money.
Yeah, I was thinking about doing that, but I'm going to be honest. My sister is going to be a freshman when I'm a senior, so I just wanted to be there for her and help her like along high school, because I know it's a big change from going to middle school to a high school with a bunch more people. It's more scary. Like, I don't know. I just want to be there for her.
You can do both. Take classes at Butte and in high school. So what would you say has been the biggest challenges in your long life so far and how you've coped?
Probably my dad passing away in 2010. I was 10 years old.
Sorry.
Thank you. I was 10 years old, and it was really hard on me. Like, I was a major daddy's girl, so of course, like, it just hurt me so bad. And, I mean, I was 10. My sister was younger at the time, too. Like, I don't know how old she was, but she was pretty young. And I think, I don't want to say it hit me the worst, but I felt it, like, probably more than she did. Because I couldn't stand when anybody would talk about him to me, like, oh, like, I'm so sorry, like, every other day. And like, oh my gosh, like, how are you? And stuff like that. It just kind of, like, really got to me. But I'm still kind of getting over that. I still have those nights where I'm like, wow, like, I can't believe he's actually gone, you know? And then I think, well, I mean, I've come this far to, like, not get over it, but kind of like move forward from it and think of the positives that have come out of it.
Mm-hmm. And what would you say that they are, like being independent or what?
Probably being independent and helping others who have probably gone through the same thing. Like one of my friends, I think her mother passed away recently, and so I was like, okay, like I'll be there for you. Like I know how it feels, and I'll help you, and I'll talk with you and stuff like that. And it's, I know where they're coming from. I mean, sure, kind of maybe a different aspect where their, like, relationship might have been different, but either way, I think I'd still be able to help them in some sense.
Mm-hmm. What about, like, peer relationships? It seems like high school is so hard because people are so judgmental about appearance and who's dating who, and it's easy to feel left out or not popular or that kind of things. How do you cope with that kind of peer pressure?
I try to just be myself and not let anybody talk down to me or look at me weird. I mean, sure, like if I, because I have like pizza socks on right now, and people are like, oh my gosh, you're wearing those. Or
what are pizza socks?
Oh, they kind of have pizzas on them.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, pizza socks. They're pizza socks, but I mean, being in high school and the pressure that people kind of put on you, or not just people, but like the society as a whole, like the way girls are supposed to look and the way they're supposed to act all ladylike and stuff like that. And I see a lot of judgment around school, like, oh my gosh, like I can't believe she's wearing that, or like giving dirty looks to people, or just like being like maybe like called names in the hallway. Like people may think it's a joke, but it's really not, and it's kind of sad to see that kids do that and to hurt each other and put people down and stuff.
People used to put people down with homophobic name calling. Do they still do that? Say you're so gay or whatever they say?
I think so. Some people, like, if they have like a homework assignment, like, oh my god, that's so gay, or something like that, or like they throw around the term faggot, and like it just makes a lot of people uncomfortable, including myself. Like, it's kind of weird just to like how does that coincide with what you're trying to say, like, and it's, I don't know, I think it might hurt other people's feelings too, so people don't really think before they talk, in a sense, or they think it's all fun and games until somebody actually steps up and says something and say that, oh, like, that hurts my feelings. That makes other people uncomfortable too. They're just too afraid to say that because everybody thinks it's a joke.
The people that I talked to, students at your high school, said the student government was just kind of a pep club and didn't really advocate for students, and there are lots of issues that need to be addressed, like homework or tests coming in clusters, the tardy policy students felt was too strict. Do you have that same perception, or do you think your student government does something to advocate for students?
I'm not really in tune with student government because, like I said, I kind of like more independent. Like, but from the things, like, I know the student government tries really hard to include everyone at our school, whether it be like the scared freshmen on the first rally, like, okay, like, come on, like, stand up, like, let's cheer and stuff like that. And it just takes that few people to get them up and going, to like the energy kind of goes around the whole gym and stuff like that. And student government, they really put a lot of time and effort into what they do, and I really appreciate them and them for that, because it's really hard, because I mean the pressure of them being in student government and having to run things and be in charge of things, like when my friend and I are trying to make a suicide prevention club, like we went to them to try to help and say, okay, well, you have to sign this form out and you have to have these signatures and stuff. So they kind of just guide everything, and then you just have to go to like your counselors and your teachers to kind of, I can't think of the word. How would I say that to?
To get it official?
To get it official, yes. To, yeah.
So did you start the suicide club, and what was the impetus?
I didn't start it. One of my friends moved here. Well, I just met her last year, and I was talking to her, and she said, well, hey, does this school have a suicide prevention club? I was like, no, like, but that'd be, like, really awesome if we'd start one. So we've been starting one, or trying to start one, since our sophomore year, and it's a long process, too, because we have to, like, educate others and go through, like, the counselors and, like, the principal, maybe, because I mean, there's some like really touchy subjects with that come along with suicide. So, I mean,
do you know of people who've thought about it?
Yes, I do, and I used to be one of them. Was what when I used to be like really depressed when I was when I moved up here and when I was living down where I used to live, and it's really hard to hear people also like throw around the term, oh, I'm gonna kill myself, very loosely, because some people actually do want to and nobody takes it serious, and it's kind of hard that people actually think it's a joke and stuff like that.
Wow, a joke?
Yeah, like it's just people, I don't understand why people just throw that term around and stuff.
Well, good for you. I think that's an important club. There probably needs to be a different name. Because who's going to join a suicide club?
Yeah, name? I think we're trying to call it Lifesavers, or and like give out like the little like Lifesavers candies, like a little
that's good.
Irony there.
I love it.
That's good. Rochelle, do you think if you were principal of your school, or if you were school superintendent, what that's better. What would you do to
you're the president?
Oh, let's not go there. What would you do to deal with students' emotional, social lives, as well as just getting them to take their SATs and get into college and keep from getting C minuses in math and stuff?
Honestly, that's a crazy question. If I was principal, if I ever were principal, I would have to be at a very small school. I would want. I think that I feel like teachers are under so much pressure to you know meet the bottom line, and they're directed by funding and state standards and things that they don't get any say in, and the principal has to follow that as well. And tons of stuff that come down through anywhere from classroom sizes to the dates of when things have to be, you know, tested and the scores and, you know, so... But what would I do for kids would be to provide, you know, a small environment, smaller, you know, and be able to...
You mean smaller class sizes or smaller schools?
I would say smaller class sizes. Well, because what teachers really, really seem to want, and it's very, very difficult to do, is to embed within the day that time when you can give that one-on-one to the student, or those small groups, or you can do character development where you can have conversations about resiliency and what's going on with you. I mean, any teacher you talk to for the most part is going to say, I want to know what was going on at home. I know there must be a reason why this kid has been absent for 5 days in a row, or why the homework has suddenly gone off. And there isn't a teacher out there that won't say, oh, that kid's got so much potential and they're smart and I want to help them. But
if you have five, or do they have six classes?
They have six classes.
Whoa.
And some of them have 42 in a class. Whoa. No, not 42, 40. but at the first day of school, we have teachers that will have to, you know, try to manage a classroom that are overcrowded to begin with until things get balanced out. And so we're lucky, we have five counselors at our school, plus an amazing school counselor or school psychologist, and we work really hard. We are constantly collaborating to talk about ways to do outreach, and so we're so thrilled when we can get students that want to provide some type of club or service, like Student Government or Lifesavers Club or any club really that allows students a place to kind of come and connect. And I think that is a...
How many students for five counselors?
Well, I suppose I have some...
What's the population of the student body?
I don't know, 1,800, 1,900?
I think it's 1,800.
And we're going to be over that, I think, next year. So I think I had 370-some students, something like that. That's, you know, about what I have, 9 through 12. So it's great. and I do feel like I don't want to say I know all of them, because not all of them know me, and that's they're finding resources other places. But for the most part, we do see every single student we see at least once a semester, and we do 4-year plans, and we talk about what do you want to do after high school. But it really is also, you know, having those conversations with them about, you know, what's your dreams, what's your goals, you know, what are your strengths, where do you really shine, you know.
And that helps with resilience, for sure. Mm-hmm. It's focusing on strengths.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's called islands of competence, there's a term. I'm seeking out the islands of what's working with you, you know, what's working, not so focusing on all your bad grades, but let's talk about these two A's that you've got, or it's the A and PE, awesome, how are you doing that, you know. You know, it's really just focusing on where they're at and building on that.
So you don't burn out?
Well, I have experienced school burnout, for sure. I have. But
And how did you cope?
Burnout is hard because you don't know that you're burnt out. If you're hardworking and you're a people pleaser and you care and you have compassion, you don't know that you're burnt out. You think you need to work more. You think you need to help as much as you possibly can. So I think it was, how did I cope? Well, things had to change, you know. So I've been at where I'm at the last 9 years, and I have an amazing, amazing support system with the counselors that I work with. But the teachers are amazing, and the administration are great. And I'm just, I know how to, what my boundaries are now, I think.
So you can say no when it's appropriate?
You know, yeah. I do that a little bit more now. Yeah.
That's part of being resilient, is knowing realistic limits of what we can do and what we can't do.
Yes, and that helps so much with kids. And I think that's where kids burn out, is where they have to be in five sports and, you know, the hours of homework. I think it's reasonable 2 to 3 hours a night, but some kids aren't I mean, a lot more. Students that are developing health risks that are actually having to see a doctor because they're so burnt out or stressed out are studying till 2-3 in the morning. Yeah. And then the mom will call me and say, I'm really worried about my daughter.
Yeah.
I'm really worried about my son. And so those are real important conversations to have.
Absolutely.
I want to add that I understand that Inspire is not giving homework.
At Chico High.
At Inspire. I don't know about
Chico High. It's part of Chico High.
They're separate.
But they are
it's on the same campus.
Okay.
Yeah. So they give a homework assignment, but it doesn't have to be turned in. So the message to the student is if you need to practice or study, you know, then do it. But it doesn't need to be turned in, which I think is awesome. I love it. I'm a big advocate of no homework.
How can you do that? How can you learn math if you don't do practice questions? And how can you learn Spanish if you don't practice?
Well, I think the thing is that some kids, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that some kids don't need to. Some kids do it at school, and then they're good. And then homework just becomes this, like, just...
busy work.
Just busy work. And then I think there are kids that do need to. And it's more like that in college. You know, you go to class, and you learn what you need to learn. And if you get it, you get it. And if you don't, then you need to read about it when you get home or whatever. So I just love the freedom of... I don't think that kids should have homework after school, because I think that... there's so little time to take risks and to be out in the world and to socialize. And
you know, Finland scores really high on world achievement tests, mm-hmm. and they don't believe in a lot of homework either.
No.
They believe that kids should have a chance to be outdoors and run around and explore and whatever. So Finland, they're high achievers and not big on homework.
Yeah.
Well, I think another thing that makes me think of, I'd heard another therapist in town talk about how, you know, learning models are so structured, and everyone says you have to learn this at this age, and then you have to learn this at that age, and so...
and you're tested on it.
And, you know, and she was sort of saying, you know, kind of back to some of the different educational models where you'll learn when you're ready, when you're really interested, when you are just dying to figure out how to do trig or to learn how to write well, you'll figure it out. So I think that could be, you know, sort of helpful in reducing some stress if there was less pressure on maybe when students had mm-hmm. to acquire certain skills, because it's funny, there's some students that come in as a ninth grader and just crushed because they can't do history. That's their favorite subject, and they loved history in junior high.
Don't you do world history in ninth grade?
No, we don't do it till 10th grade.
Ah.
And that's okay. I mean, I'm fine with whatever is going on, but it does kind of remind me of just if kids could pick the three subjects that they were the best at and most wanted to learn, they'd probably be doing homework, you know, all the time. Artists, kids that are artists, they're doodling all the time, and that's homework. That is the way they're learning their skill or their craft, you know. And you know, kids that love science will be tinkering around. I had a student that was into robotics, and they were finding little pieces and parts all over and building in their friend's garage and competing and all that, and it was extra. It wasn't anything that was assigned, you know, and that is what he was going to major in college too, so.
Right.
Yeah.
PV students illustrated my Mindful Guide to Academic Success Prevent Burnout book.
Oh, that's great.
And a student did the cover too.
Oh, neat.
Yeah.
Oh wow. That's great.
Katie, you have three kids, so how do you teach them resilience? So moving from your clients to people you see every day.
Right. I thought a lot about this question. I think that luckily I had read and actually taught a lot about attachment when my kids were babies. So I have a 13-year-old, 11-year-old, and a 7-year-old, and I have a 27-year-old stepdaughter. So I met her when she was 8. But I knew a lot about just reflecting emotion and skin-to-skin contact and all these things that are so important in the very beginning. And I would say that I think that that is why my kids are resilient, because I hope they're resilient. I am assuming they're resilient. I see them as resilient because they know that anything that they experience, they can share with us, and that... it's okay. you know.
So they're very open with you guys. So
yeah.
They tell you where they're going.
Yeah. And I think...
parents' phone numbers and stuff like that.
Yes. And I think that, you know, it's not what happens to kids that, in terms of when traumatic things happen or bad things happen to any of us, it's not what actually happens to us. It is what happens after what happens to us. And if we're able to go to someone and say, this happened to me.
That's interesting.
And that person says, oh my gosh, how can I support you?
They don't know how to react.
Right.
With the Suicide Prevention Club, my friend and I think we were at the district and we were talking about this. I guess one of the teachers overheard a student or something like that, and they didn't know how to approach it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think teaching kids at a young age to let them know that it's okay to tell somebody like how you're feeling, no matter how they might think of you. It's
right.
still important to tell them how you feel so they can know how to help you, because the teacher, they didn't know how to approach the situation. They didn't know what to say. So
mm-hmm.
I think it's very important for kids to know that everybody's there for them, no matter how they feel or how the kids think that the parents are teachers or whomever they're going to tell is going to react.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you have that with your mom, that you can tell her anything?
Yeah, I do. I'm very thankful for that. Yeah.
That's great.
Katie, how are you coping dealing with a teenager, an adolescent? What kind of issues are coming up?
My 13-year-old?
Yeah.
Well, our biggest thing is wanting to see scary movies.
Oh.
And I don't like anything scary, so I cannot preview movies, but I'll read on the internet or I'll ask people. And then the thing for me that I tell my 13-year-old is you can't unsee something. So you may think that you want to see this, but you can't unsee it. And so I impose limits around that, and my 13-year-old is not happy about that, but...
because her peers are watching them?
Well, that is always the message. Well, everybody else gets to go. And then it turns out, of course, everybody else doesn't get to go.
Yeah.
But, you know, I also know that at a certain point, they have to do it. And then they have to see something that's scary. And then they have to live with the being scared at night. And that's the natural consequence. So for me, that's always the question, like... do I mow the lawn? You know, do I clear the stuff out of the way, or do I let them do it?
Mm-hmm.
I try to give my kids a lot of independence, physical independence. And I also want them to know that there's a safe box, you know, around them, that I get to make those big decisions, or, you know, my husband and I. So,
What do you expect of them in terms of work around the home?
They are always... needing to help. I think it's really important for kids to help. I worked, had a real job when I was in sixth grade and never stopped working.
What did you do in sixth grade? You babysat?
I always babysat, but I also worked at Ray's Video.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was our family friends owned it. So
when you were in sixth grade?
From sixth grade on.
What did you do? You stopped?
We got the movies out of the Dropbox and we put them away. And it was horribly
nice.
Boring. And it was a huge character developer for us. Because we had to be there, and we got paid, and we learned to deal with people and people who were upset, and we had to miss things we wanted to do because we had a responsibility, and it was also great because we always had money, so that was wonderful. So my kids, I do expect them.
Do you give them an allowance or not? Or
not really. We always try to do that, but we're not organized enough. For me, there are things that they just need to do because they're part of the family, and that's being part of the family is helping out. Extra things that I would pay someone else to do or that take a lot of time, I will pay them to do. But, yeah, I think that's really important.
What do they say? Nah, I don't want to do the dishes.
I'll say, great. Guess what? We have Circle and your Wi-Fi is paused. So Wi-Fi is the big thing, right? Using screens in our house. So if they want to do that, then they have to do what they're supposed to do first.
So they have natural consequences.
Yeah.
I love Driver's Children, the challenge that you don't give the lectures, you don't give monologues, you just let the consequence be the teacher.
Right.
I want to shift to girls in a minute, but first, let's do the promo. Ask Dr. Gale is made possible by the generous contributions of KZFR supporters and by Chico Certified Farmers Markets, presenting farmers markets throughout Butte County. Year-round markets are Saturday mornings in downtown Chico and Wednesday mornings at North Valley Mall in Chico. The Chico Certified Farmers Market, connecting farmers and food lovers since 1980. It's also brought to you by Peter Titchinen, in association with Baywood Real Estate, a local real estate firm established in 1962. Peter and Baywood Real Estate are happy to support community radio and can be reached at 680-1900 or at chicohomes.com. And just a reminder, the opinions expressed on this show aren't necessarily those of KZFR and its underwriters. And I would like to let you know that there's going to be a March for Science on April 22nd. Can you believe that in 2017 we have to march for science? Mm-hmm. But we do.
Crazy.
It's very crazy. Oh, boy. So if you are interested, there's a Facebook page on the March for Science in Chico, and it's going to be held at Chico State Trinity Commons. It starts at 11, and there'll be all kinds of booths for kids and other people to have exploratory experiments, and there'll be different groups. And then there'll be some speeches at 12, and then there'll be a march around 12:30. So mark your calendar April 22nd. And then this Saturday is the Nut Festival, and KZFR is going to have a table there, and I'll be there from 12 to 2. And I invite you to suggest topics for the next month's show. So Ask Dr. Gale is the second Thursday of each month, and I'm very open to your questions and comments. And you can email me at gkimble@csuchico.edu. I want to turn to girls, because what the studies show is that the reports of increased anxiety among young people are girls are the ones, and I want to know if that's because they're just more likely to say I'm anxious and depressed and seek help, and boys just stuff it, or what's going on there? Who wants to take that?
Maybe our girl.
Oh. Okay.
Well, I think where the whole societal pressure around the girls kind of begins is kind of in middle school, because when you're younger, like in the fifth grade, because I remember just wearing those bell-bottom jeans and my hair like cut up to like my jawline, just not giving like one single crap what everybody thought about me. I just kind of just did my own thing and was my own person. But up until middle school, I was always worried about, oh my goodness, like I can't wear these jeans anymore. Nobody's wearing these jeans, or nobody's wearing these shoes. And so I think the pressure from society and the standards that society also holds is a very big anxiety and stressor on young girls, even boys too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why is it more on girls?
Because they have a certain image, like on the magazines, like to be skinny, to have a thigh gap, and to just be overall, just be very skinny and just like little, like a stick figure. And
so girls are judged on their appearance and boys on their achievements?
I think so, because boys, like, you know how high school boys are, you know, most of them, you know, chase after one thing, and some girls, they just kind of, they just want to fit into society and be able to say that they look a certain way, like the girl in the magazine, or they have self-confidence issues and self-esteem issues and stuff.
That's true. There's like, there aren't any boy equivalents of Teen Vogue and Seventeen, are there? They're like outdoor magazines or something.
Yeah, or like guys with abs and stuff, or like, let's see, Gatorade commercials and the whole like ab thing, like, oh, I'm so strong and stuff like that. Yeah.
But your abs aren't as obvious as, you know, what you wear to school.
Yeah.
You don't see boys' abs, hopefully,
right,
at school.
No. I'm just saying, like, in general, like, maybe boys want to kind of make themselves look good too, like, the whole, like, looking fit. And I think boys
Which
have
is
that,
healthy, so that's...
Yeah, being healthy is also, like, being fit too. But I think the boys are more focused on being fit and also healthy, and some girls too, but I think the main focus for girls is whether they're pretty or not, or whether they're skinny enough.
That's still true?
Yeah.
Oh,
I know.
It's kind of sad.
It's horrifying.
Yeah. I mean,
Is there pressure on girls not to appear too smart, to be a brain?
Ooh, I don't know. I think if a girl really wants to be smart, she'll show that she is smart, because brains are everything, and that's going to get you wherever you want in life. I mean, maybe not wherever, but to some good places that you want to be in. And I think the perception of nerds and brainiacs and stuff like that is just kind of, it's kind of, how would I say that? It's kind of weird, because people who are looking at them like, oh my gosh, they're smart and they dress that way and stuff like that, it's just kind of odd to see that you're making fun of somebody based on how smart they are.
Whoa. So we just have a few minutes left. Katie, Rochelle, I'm assuming you see more female students or female clients that come and ask for help?
I really got to say, I think I feel equal. I think I have... You know, I wouldn't want to say that I have more girls that come in and have concerns than I do boys. And the young men that come in and see me that are telling me about pressures at home or pressures with their friends or dealing with a variety of issues, they're really the same, you know, in terms of... And it all kind of comes down to, I think, something that Katie was saying earlier, which is that need to be seen, that need to feel like they can believe in themselves and have somebody believe in them. And when they don't have that, whether it was something that from when they were very young or just from suddenly the changes that they go through because they're teenagers and now they're developing their own identity and personality, I don't see that being a whole lot different male, female. They might express it differently, they may communicate it a little bit differently, but the teenage years are brutal.
Yeah.
And I want to say really seriously that every kid that shows up every day to school is exhibiting tremendous resilience.
Yeah.
So they
self-love
are, you know,
yeah,
self-love and self-esteem and self-motivation to put themselves in a position every single day where they could be judged or made fun of or that's just new. I mean,
it makes them stronger.
I don't take the kind of risk that teenagers take every day. I know who I'm going to see every day, and
yeah,
I know that they like me, but kids got to walk down the halls with a bunch of strangers looking at them or not, and every single day their bodies are a little bit different, and
hormones kicking in.
You know, I play it safe, and kids don't, and that's their nature, and that's how they grow. But that is those. That's why it's very tumultuous, I think. And
Katie, you want to talk about that? Are women, girls more able to ask for help and they just show up as more anxious and depressed, or they really are more anxious?
Well, it's interesting because I have, in my practice, I see a lot of emergency personnel and I see a lot of men. And often, I think that men in our culture don't get as much support as they need.
Yeah.
And I think that starts when they're little and people are telling them to shake it off or you're fine.
Be a man.
Be a man.
Yeah, don't be a sissy.
Right.
Stop
all
crying,
of that stuff.
You're
be a big boy.
Yeah, yeah. So I see 40-year-old men who are, how do I say this?
Hurting.
They're hurting and they're incredibly resilient and they're still doing their jobs and
yes,
they're doing them well.
Yes.
And they don't even know how to say I need help,
mm-hmm,
you know,
and
so
afraid to cry.
Yeah. So I think that you know, I don't think it's an issue of gender or sex. I think that it's an issue of where did you learn to get support? How did you learn to get support or not?
Mm-hmm.
And can you find it now? You know, can you find it when you need it? I think that's the
right issue. So Katie, Rochelle, and Marie, thank you so much. We're going to go out on a CD that I put together for kids called Kids Mind Power to Develop Resilience.
Good job.
It's all here. I'll get my tape when you start my CD.